Hey everyone, so tonight we're going to talk about gold at Bedrock. Where's that? Well, we'll talk a little bit about kind of what you're looking for when you get down to Bedrock. You know, the three rules, three rules. Gold goes downhill, downstream, and down to Bedrock. This is the third of those rules. We're going to visit that a little bit. Talk a little bit about geology and rocks and minerals, and kind of poke at, in a figurative and real sense, what's down there. Okay, and what you're looking for and why, because I always focus on the why so that you can understand a little bit more about where gold hides and what it might do under different circumstances. Hi, I'm Prospector Jess. I'm here to help you find more gold. So tonight we're going to visit Bedrock, not the Flintstones, Bedrock. You might not remember the Flintstones, depends on how old you are, but I remember. Anyway, gold at Bedrock, what are we talking about here? Let's visit a little bit of the chalk talk tonight and talk a little more about what it is we're looking at when we're looking at gold down on Bedrock and what it is you might be able to do when you talk about recovering gold there. I'll give you a hint, sniping. Okay, we'll talk somewhat about sniping tonight and just kind of discover what it is that makes that such an attractive thing to do. And here's the deal, guys. In most areas where there's all kinds of regulations, there's not a whole lot of regulations on sniping, okay? Other than gold panning itself, okay? So if you can pan gold, you can probably snipe. And if you can snipe, you can probably find gold of various sizes, including some pretty good sized nuggets, if you know what you're looking for. One of the things you want to look for is the bedrock characteristics. So we'll talk a little bit about that tonight, and let's get over to the chalkboard. So, as we look at the concept of bedrock, we have kind of a model I always refer to here. It's just real simple. And that is the stuff that's underneath everything else. So I always paint it kind of red. And I draw it with, you know, sort of this texture, kind of give you an indication this stuff is generally harder than the surrounding material. That's the key feature. What you may not know, though, is down on bedrock, there may be a few outstanding characteristics. I'll get to that in a second. The major thing on bedrock that you have to be aware of is all of the junk above it, okay? Because here's the river bottom. It's up here somewhere. And it consists of, you know, boulders, cobbles, and oh my, okay? Sand, gravel, all that stuff. This is what we refer to as overburden. You got to get through it to get to bedrock. Now, why would you want to get to bedrock? Because that's where gold goes. Now, we typically get this vision that the gold is going to be right here on the bedrock surface, and it may be, okay? But in many cases, as we're going to show you in a minute here, it may not be, okay? You say, what? Yeah, it could be up here in these other layers. There's other reasons that it might stratify somewhere else. A flash flood that doesn't cut all the way to bedrock will do that, and a bunch of other things. But we're not going to talk about that tonight. What we're talking about is, what about this area down in here called bedrock itself, okay? I didn't leave enough room for my question mark, but you get the idea, okay? So, if we're down looking inside the bedrock itself, then we look at the structure of the bedrock. And one of the first things we're going to look for are cracks, okay? Which might be cracks and fissures that might split in several ways, so there might be more than one crack down there. We're also going to look at another characteristic, and that is we might look for protrusions, okay? These are mineral depositions, typically like quartz fissures, that kind of stuff, quartz stringers, rather. Or it could be some kind of quartz stringer that's down inside the bedrock in a way that leaves the surface of this bedrock indented. And that's an ideal condition, because what that amounts to is there may be a source for gold down in here, actually, as well as just simply, even if it's not containing gold itself, you know, this thing, even if there isn't gold inside of this quartz stringer, the stringer itself, depending upon the type of bedrock, and that's why I said it might be protruding or not, depending upon whether the bedrock is softer or harder than this difference in material. The key thing here is, geologically speaking, we're looking at minerals and rocks. that are harder or softer than one another. And when a harder rock sits next to one that's soft, the softer one gives way first. That's just the rule of thumb, okay? So what ends up happening is if the bedrock is actually, you know, a little more rugged than the stringer, than quartz, and quartz is pretty hard stuff, but it's brittle as all get out. So if it can withstand the abrasion and wear better than the quartz, because the quartz shatters and heads downstream, it's glass, then what's going to happen here is we're going to end up with a little pocket. And that little pocket looks something like this. Let me see if I can... This is what the river does over time. It's taken me a long time to erase this stuff. Okay, so now once we have this opening, you kind of get an idea that this looks an awful lot like a sluice box riffle. Yeah, it sure does. And so what ends up happening here is we have this situation where all of a sudden this what was there is no longer. And now it starts to collect gold down in here, kind of like a sluice box would. Now, one of the differences is it may end up be, you know, strong enough that the gold can collect in a pile here and be of various types and so forth. But the beauty is you can go down in there and, you know, either dredge it out or scoop it out, depending upon what you got. If this is a very narrow sliver, then that's where we get into the business of using sniping tools. Okay, what's a sniping tool, you say? Well, sniping tool is simply typically one of the easiest ones to make would be a screwdriver, a long handled screwdriver, and long stemmed screwdriver, short handle but long. And then what happens is you heat it and bend it at 90 degrees, or you buy one that's built this way, and it'll have a little spoon out here. Okay, now why would I do that? Because now I can go down into this area and scoop this material out of this hole. Now, how do you do that? Well, one, you wear a swim mask or even swim goggles will do, or you can wear a regular old fashioned, you know, underwater scuba or skin diving mask and a snorkel, and away you go with your, you know, wear whatever you got to keep yourself warm. You might need a weight belt just to kind of neutralize your buoyancy so you can stay there long enough. Be careful account for all the standard swimming safety issues, okay? But the idea is you're going to go down in there and kind of scrape this stuff up and put it into a, you know, some kind of a platter or bucket or a jar, and then take it up and pan it out. You get all the material, the black sands, everything, all the crud from this hole. You want to get down into the hole. But here's the deal. These holes can be extremely rich in gold, simply from gold that gets trapped from going downstream. But as I pointed out earlier, if you take an underwater metal detector, you might actually find something more interesting inside that quartz stringer, because the gold may or may not have come from the stream. It may also have come from the deteriorating stringer if it has a fair amount of pyrites in it, because pyrites will tend to deteriorate into sulfuric acid and help destroy that quartz, make it brittle, make it dissolve even if it's strong enough. And so what ends up happening here is this whole thing can become a pocket placer, if you will, that you can scoop out with your handy dandy sniping tools. And all you need is this guy and some kind of swim goggles. Let's see, draw that like this, right? And away you go. Yeah. So if you have fun finding things underwater, then you'll love this kind of tool and this kind of arrangement. It's pretty straightforward. Now, the other thing you want to look for is the stringer may protrude. You know, so that's part one. Part two is over here, where the stringer may protrude from the surface because it's kind of more durable and harder and the other stuff wears out. That can lead to, again, a trap behind it. Not necessarily the same kind of thing as that big dipping mess, but it can lead to a situation that looks an awful lot like, you know, a riffle in a thing. This can be a situation you get into quite commonly if there's a lot of slates, which will have alternating fissures and cracks and stems sticking out of the bedrock, okay? And so it can even be the bedrock itself. But that means that down in here are cracks and fissures that can contain gold going down the backside of one of these slots of slate. And so you want to keep your eyes peeled for that kind of material. That's this stuff. Okay, and so it has this really interesting, you know, flat platey structure. You can see how it's almost glossy, okay? But these things are they're like glass, okay? And so they shatter, but more importantly, they form these riffles. And you can imagine that if the water's going downstream, Let me see if I can aim this right. If the water's going downstream over this surface, if this thing's tilted at the right angle, it's going to trap gold behind it. And of course, you're going to want to go look in there, if not split out some of that stuff. And that's where you get into the number two tool here, which would be, you know, something really straightforward called the crowbar, the golden crowbar. And so that's the idea, is, you know, you get in and look at these places in the fissures and cracks, and you're looking for jagged depressions that trap gold. You're looking for any kind of cracks and depression kind of oriented things that might create a vortex or an eddy that might slow the water down enough to trap gold. You're looking for your joints and cracks that go down deep along these edges, and again, like this stuff, where you can find that the gold gets trapped in between the different rocks themselves, or different types of rocks. Another place that I've seen, quite common here in California, it's actually pretty common everywhere, there's gold, and that is faults and fissures, okay? Because these are also the places that tend to be weakened and bring in the secondary hydrothermal. Those quartz stringers come up along these things, but faults and fissures are notorious weak spots in bedrock. And so what ends up happening is they end up being places where this stuff will naturally kind of gouge out, water will leach through and weaken the material, etc. And pretty soon there'll be a place where gold can kind of go down and hide out down below. Great place, again, for sniping and picking, as well as detecting. You know, all of these things are interesting underwater detecting possibilities. And by the way, not just underwater. When the water, you know, recedes and there's stuff covering over from the last flood, these are places that you might find on the hillsides that would tell you, okay, this is an area where we have a fault. We have a quartz stringer. We had an old ancient riverbed going through here. Huh. Do you think it's going to be any different if it's high and dry than if it's wet? No, it's not. That's the other thing you want to look for. Look for these ancient flows where there were ancient exposures of the bedrock to the bottom of the river where gold would collect. Makes natural sense. So that's what we're talking about tonight. Real quick one, gold at bedrock. Where would I find it? And what do I do? And the answer is, well, sniping. Get out your scuba gear. Get cooled off. It's hot out. Have fun. Go find some gold. Take care, guys. Good prospecting and good night. Bye-bye.